Welcome to This Week in Money. I'm Jim Goddard. Today, CIBC Bundgundy's Ross Clark disputes the ability of central banks to control the economy. International forecaster reporter James Corbett on China's free market attempt blunders. And real estate expert Robert Campbell believes San Francisco's real estate bubble is about to explode. We'll talk to Ross Clark right after this.
Unbelievable harmonies, spectacular performance, Bird Dog and the Vintage Electric Band, the ultimate tribute to the Everly Brothers and Simon and Garfunkel. In Oliver, October 2nd. In Kelowna, October 3rd. Buy online and save at OnTourTickets.com.
Welcome to This Week in Money, the source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Ross Clark, investment advisor at CIBC Bundgundy in Vancouver. Welcome back to This Week in Money, Ross.
Always enjoy this.
Well, you were saying we're about to talk about the most overhyped announcement, sound and fury signifying nothing?
Well, pretty much. I mean, here we were going into this week, the FOMC, the Federal Open Market Committee, talking about what they're going to do with interest rates. And remember that the Fed typically is a follower, not a leader, when it comes to the rate market, the open market where we trade the bonds and other interest rate products that are anything other than a T-bill are pretty much established and priced by the marketplace. So here we have the hyped event. The Fed decides to do nothing. They look at it and say that on a domestic basis, that inflation and employment numbers are not enough that they would really push them into raising rates. And more so, even they made mention about the international situation regarding the non-American, non-domestic conditions that are out there. And so, you know, the Fed is clearly moving away from its original mandate and opening up, and probably rightfully so, because we are so much a world market economy rather than just individual economies.
So where do we go from here? How do the markets react?
Well, you know, interest rates will probably, you know, now when you take a look at the stats that we've got in terms of measurements of the probability for rate moves, the one in October probably looks very unlikely, maybe December, but most of the models are now showing January before there be any move in rates. So with that, you get a pretty good move here on the upside in the bond market. U.S. dollar took a hit right off the news, but bounced back as of the close of Friday. But, you know, the equity market was the one that got excited for the first hour or so after the announcement, but then gave it back, and even more so into the end of the week. The at this point, you know, I guess what's being read into it is that the Fed doesn't see the economy strong enough to raise rates, and so the implication is that the equity market, for those who are trading in the equity markets, that it's best to pull back your reins a little bit. Now, from our perspective, from a technical perspective, looking at it, we had that bad break into August the 24th. We had a 17-day recovery or relief rally. The market recovered about, depending upon the index you look at, anywhere up to 40 or 50% of the decline. And it became overbought on the short-term oscillators by the time we got into Tuesday, Wednesday. And it looks as though this consolidation phase that we've been talking about, that I think we're into, we've seen the top end of that rally right now. And the norm, when we look back, and we're using the analogs of years when the Dow Industrials was not being confirmed by the transports, as we saw in the first half of this year, and when you get the ensuing hard breaks, that 15% break such as we had into August, you go into these consolidation phases, and the interim rally that we've seen, say that took 17 days, the retest of the low would usually take that much in terms of time, or possibly a little bit longer. And so as we move into next week, we had mentioned that we've just finished, as of Friday, a quadruple witching what's called a quadruple witching in the options market and in the futures market. That's where options and futures expirations on the calendar quarter come to a conclusion. And with that, the week after, that would be this coming week, has a very poor track record. So the probability of the market going down and testing support, I would say between here and the end of the month, the probability of us going down and testing the lows is really high on our modeling right now.
If people were running to bonds, are they going anywhere else?
Well, the precious metals got a bit of a lift here as well this week, because without higher interest rates become a competitor to the precious metals, it took a bit of the lid off of here. So gold's had a pretty decent move up off the low, and we closed off the week around 1139. This had been down just around $1,100 early part of the week, so pretty good bounce in there. And it comes from a point where we've had very, very poor sentiment readings, lows that are infrequent. We've probably seen maybe half a dozen levels like this since the top of the market in 2011. And during the bear market of 1997 to 2002, that market, we saw a number of readings down where we are. And such rallies, typically we're getting back to the 20 or the 50-week moving averages, and that, in this case, would be up in the 1145 to 1190 range. I think we can be looking at that as a potential cap on the gold market in this next week or two, and I don't think we're going to pop through the top end, primarily because when we were at the lows, we did not see a bullish divergence in the mining stocks versus the bullion. In other words, if this was a strong market, the stocks would have been putting in a higher low, and they didn't. They were working their way right down into lower lows, the lowest lows of the year, just before the turn this week, whereas at the good bottoms in the past, the miners tend to lead at the bottom. And so with that, as I say, we're probably looking at a lid that's going to be still be shy of $1,200.
Ross, thanks a lot for chatting with us.
And we'll be with you next week, Jim.
My guest has been Ross Clark, investment advisor at CIBC Wood Gundy Vancouver. If you have any questions for Ross, you can email him at ross.clark@cibc.ca. Coming up next, James Corbett on This Week in Money.
Always consult your investment professional before making any investment decision. This Week in Money is archived online at talkdigitalnetwork.com.
My guest is James Corbett, publisher of The Corbett Report and reporter for the International Forecaster. Welcome to the show, James.
Well, it's a pleasure to be back. I'm always glad to talk to you.
You just finished a documentary on 9/11. Can you tell us about it?
Yes, I am exploring some of the money trails of 9/11, which I think is a vastly under-researched and under-reported field of study, but one that is absolutely fascinating when you start to look into it, which is interesting because the 9/11 Commission, the government's final word on it, in Chapter 5 of the Commission report actually says that they have not been able to determine where the financing for the attacks came from, but it is of, quote, little practical significance, which is a mind-boggling thing for a commission that was supposedly investigating those attacks to say that the money trail is doesn't really matter. It, of course, goes against one of the fundamental tenets of criminal investigation, follow the money. So I just put together a report looking at just a few of the financial aspects of 9/11. It's called 9/11 Trillions, Follow the Money. It's available free on YouTube or on my website. And we look at some of the interesting things about that day and some of the people who profited to the tunes of, well, billions of dollars in the case of someone like Larry Silverstein of Silverstein Properties and things of that nature. So people can check that out. And as with all my work, all of the documents that I talk about are linked in the transcript for that documentary.
I was going to say the first thing you learn when you take a class in investigative journalism is follow the money.
Those people investigating 9/11 never read that, never heard that before?
Apparently not. No, of course, if we're expected to take that at face value, then they're just incompetent. But I think we have to look a little bit deeper than that, especially when you look into the business connections of some of the people who were sitting on the 9/11 Commission itself, including one of the co-chairs, Thomas Kane, who had business dealings back in the 1980s with a group called BMI. He had a real estate property deal to the tune of $24 million. With his BMI that went on to found or to invest in a company called P-Tech, which provided some very interesting software that basically allowed backdoor access to everything from the Secret Service to the White House to the Air Force to the NORAD and the FAA. I mean, it was in all of these different computer systems. And it was partially funded into existence by BMI, and it was also partially funded into existence by Yasin al-Qadi, who was later designated as a globally specially designated terrorist by the U.S. Treasury Department itself, although he was later taken off that list. During that time, when he was on the list as a globally specially designated terrorist, the U.S. government seemed remarkably uninterested in investigating him or his connection to this company or what that actually means for what actually took place on 9/11. And then, of course, later you have Thomas Kane, one of the people who co-invested in that company with Yasin al-Qadi, sitting on the board of the 9/11 Commission, which, of course, did not even look at the question of P-Tech and the software it was providing with this backdoor access to these government agencies. So that's just one of the slivers of a tiny topic that makes up a much larger picture of not just incompetence when it comes to not looking at the money trail, but it seems actively avoiding certain areas that would be uncomfortable for various players with interests in seeing that investigation covered up.
Does this give more fuel to the people who back conspiracy theories about 9/11?
Well, I don't really know about conspiracy theories. All I'm trying to do is take a look at some of the facts that we can document and cite and some of the things that show visible, provable conflicts of interest between the people who were directly profiting from or had things to cover up in the investigation that then ended up doing so. And the fact that, of course, the 9/11 Commission ended up investigating the largest terror attack in history, the largest attack on U.S. soil, and not only came to the conclusion that there was no money trail to follow, but also did not reprimand or demote or cause any sort of career difficulties for any of the people who were involved in this monumental, unthinkable dereliction of duty and complete abject failure to protect the country on that morning. That alone should be ringing alarm bells for a lot of people. And the fact that it was just swept under the rug so quickly, really, and still continues to form the basis for American foreign policy and the wars of aggression we've seen around the world for the last decade and a half should at least get a few people asking some questions. So this is my humble attempt to get some of those questions on the table.
Sounds like it was the same people who investigated the assassination of President Kennedy.
Well, yes, it's interesting. I just had a recent podcast episode about Alan Dulles, of course, the director of the CIA until he was fired by Kennedy after the Bay of Pigs debacle, who ended up being on the Warren Commission to investigate JFK's assassination after JFK had not only fired Dulles, but said famously to one of his aides, "I'm going to splinter the CIA into 1,000 pieces and scatter those pieces to the winds." That's a direct quote quoted in the New York Times. And a couple of years later, he gets his head blown off in broad daylight, and one of the people that he fired, and an extremely important, influential person, ends up on the Warren Commission investigating his death, which comes to the conclusion that it was all a lone nut. So make of that what you will, but I certainly have my own reservations about the findings of the Warren Commission as well as the 9/11 Commission.
Taking a look at something that's pretty interesting in today's world, and maybe following the money might be just as hard as it was in 9/11, the Chinese stock exchange, the Chinese government putting in new controls and now saying we won't spend billions to support it, but we'll send to jail or do other things to people who caused this disaster on our stock market. Are they just trying to cover up their own mistakes?
Well, again, this is another case of just absolute, incredible, out of control central bank engineering and manipulation of an economy, and then the abject failure or the complete abandonment of the idea of actually taking responsibility for those decisions when they come home to roost. So the Chinese stock market has been on fire for the last year or two since it's been more or less tacitly admitted by the People's Bank of China that they were going to back up whatever was happening in the stock market. There was a nudge and a wink to investors that don't worry, we've got it under control. So we saw people piling into the stock market especially over the past year. And we saw the results of that in July when, of course, the emperor was shown to have no clothing, and we saw what started to happen. So despite the enormous amount of effort the Chinese government has put into trying to backstop that market, it still, of course, is pretty shaky. It's still up from where it was last year, but it's lost, obviously, a lot of its gains and been exposed as really nothing more than a pump-and-dump scheme of some sort. And of course, who's left holding the bag for that? It's everyone who has been playing in this market by those government-created rules who are now finding that the rules of the game are changing even as it's happening before them. So we have one of the latest headlines, for example, from ZeroHedge.com. In China, 1,300 hedge funds did not fight the central bank and are now liquidating. So we see the results of this. Basically, you have to play in the stock market. If you try to take your money out, there are people being prosecuted for doing so, for shorting the markets or causing financial panic. We've had journalists thrown in jail for trying to report on anomalies and things that were going on in the stock market. And now we have people who ended up having to basically hold the bag and take their losses are now liquidating because they can't afford to stay in the market any longer. It's a mess, no matter what way you look at it. And I think it's just another example, perhaps a prime example, of how central engineering of the economy is not only wrong, it's dangerously wrong.
Well, all these quantitative easing efforts around the world, every stock exchange, it seems, has done it. Has that been just a waste of money? Because no matter what central banks try to do or governments try to do, invariably, if you look at history, stock markets will at some point go down.
Yes, they will. And we've strangely been painted into this corner by the Federal Reserve and its cheerleaders that there now is the expectation that stocks will never go down again. We saw the panic that hit during that drop on the Black Monday of a few weeks ago, and the fact that basically the idea seems to be that if there is any sort of correction in the market now, it's seen as something abnormal and something that must be prevented, which, I mean, is just completely, I mean, it goes against all economic history and the basic principles of what underlies the economy. But that's the kind of manipulated reality that we're living in now, especially in this era of QE, quantitative easing, post-QE, whatever we're in right now, this kind of limbo. So just to underscore the fact that this has been a extremely unusual period of economic and monetary policy history, we had, in fact, one of the governors of the New York Fed, Bill Dudley, just last year come out and say, we don't understand, this is a direct quote, we don't understand fully how large-scale asset purchase programs work to ease financial market conditions. Translation, we don't know how QE works. I mean, it's a stunning thing for one of the New York Fed governors to admit, but perhaps it is not all that surprising, because ultimately the whole quantitative easing idea has been one big experiment that's been being played on the economy. And although it certainly has inflated the asset bubble, especially in equities, and we have seen, of course, the bond bubble blowing and blowing and blowing, we still don't know where this is going to end up. And that's why this Fed rate hike, will they, won't they, is so important, because ultimately we can see the popping of this bubble, and it's not going to be happy for anyone when it comes. I think there may be a few people who are situated to brace for it, but I think the dollar unwind that could happen, especially the very little talked about dollar carry trade that's taken place in emerging economies over the last few years based on this strong dollar and attractive rates in emerging economies, the unwinding of that trade could be disastrous for the global economy as a whole. So we're looking at really the fruits of this QE craziness coming home to roost, and potentially even as early as this week, if not in the near future.
Well, I understand with the U.S. dollar climbing, of course, servicing foreign debt becomes more expensive for all these small countries that borrowed at a low interest rate, but in American dollars, and that's one of the problems that we're facing, right?
That's one of them, yes, and there are many others. There's the reverse Yankee bonds, where you've had a lot of American corporations taking out bond or putting out bonds denominated in euros, for example, to try to take advantage of the spread there. And all of those types of trades can come can come undone very quickly if there's significant movement amongst relative movement amongst the players, and that's exactly what can and will happen, presumably so, if the Fed does ultimately hike rates and we see another strengthening of the dollar compared to all of these other poorest houses in the block. Well, the dollar is the best looking house in a bad neighborhood, so it will stand to benefit once again from this, but that is not a good thing for the global economy, which has been so leveraged against the rise of the dollar, and has been so leveraged in favor of this idea that the stimulus is going to last forever, that, again, as I say, the markets are now pretty much expecting, they're almost betting on the fact that the markets will never go down again. And that's such an extremely dangerous place to be in, because ultimately all that does is blow the bubble up further and further and further and further.
And that's going to give us the Big Bang Theory, right?
Yes, and unfortunately this Big Bang is not going to create a universe, or at least not a universe that most people want to live in. And I actually wrote about this recently for The Forecaster. I wrote about how the Bank for International Settlements just came out with some startling facts and figures and ideas in one of their new quarterly reports, and there was a press conference about this, that basically they're ringing the alarm bell right now that central banks have been manipulating the economy too much and for too long, and that now we're in a very precarious situation. And as Ambrose Evans-Pritchard, writing for The Telegraph, noted, the BIS was one of the only global bodies that was warning about the state of affairs back in 2007 before the Lehman collapse. Well, now they're ringing the alarm bell here, and unfortunately, I don't think it's because the BIS has the best interests of the people at heart. I think it's because they're positioning themselves to be the saviors of the economic system when the collapse ultimately happens. And I think the type of saving of the system they want to accomplish is going to involve the IMF and the World Bank and the BRICS and these large multinational groupings of countries to come together under some sort of global monetary order, which, of course, I think has been the end game of this gambit all along.
We're paying a lot of attention to the European migration crisis. Is the same kind of thing happening in Asia? We just don't hear about it?
In some countries, there are, like in Indonesia and Malaysia and places like that, there is more of a refugee issue. But in places like Japan, it's quite the other way around, in fact, where I live. The Japanese population is shrinking at this point. There were more deaths than births, I think, for the first time in 2013, and that trend is only going to exacerbate as the Japanese aging population continues to die off more quickly than the birth rate increases, or decreases, I should say. So, yes, Japan is actually in the situation where it needs some economic migrants to come here to find jobs, but the Japanese have been very closed to that type of migration. So it very, very much varies from country to country, but there are some that are obviously on the periphery and in certain strategic areas that I think economic migrants are making their way to.
Well, I understand Germany takes a look at the migrants as an asset. They say, sure, it'll cost money to set them up and educate them, but, you know, we have an aging population. We'll need young people to support our economy. Why can't Japan take a look at that?
Well, it's a big gambit to play, and I think we have to also be skeptical of whether or not we can take those kinds of ideas at face value, of whether that's the ultimate purpose in this. But even if we were to take that at face value, the question is always what kind of contributions to the economy is going to be made through this. So, I mean, I think quite famously, the sort of illegal immigration in the United States with the illegal immigrants has always been seen as a type of trade-off, where you get these undocumented workers who get to do the types of jobs that Americans wouldn't want to do at the rates they wouldn't want to do it, and there's a sort of economic benefit, quote-unquote, to that. But ultimately, to what extent is that contributing to the economy as a whole, to a productive economy, a thriving economy? I think the ultimate ideal for people who actually care about the country as a whole is to attract the types of, you know, high-level economic immigrants who will contribute something to the sort of higher end of the scale. But the question is, can that be done, and can that be done productively, and can that be done at the rate that it's needed to be? Japan does have some factory workers and things that come from Brazil. There's always been a Brazilian-Japanese relationship that creates almost a kind of secondary, second-class citizen here in Japan. But But other than that, they've been very closed door for a long time. So I don't think that's coming to Japan anytime soon. And in Germany and places like that, obviously known for its manufacturing capabilities, the question is, are manufacturing jobs going to start being given to lower skilled, lower rate labor of the economic migrant variety rather than Germans themselves? And does that really benefit the German economy? I mean, there's a lot of things to think about when you talk about that. And it's not just a question of the numbers per se, but also how those numbers are being arrived at.
Plus, we're being told low-skilled jobs are all going to be taken over by robots in 5 years.
Well, hey, if people can do it cheaper than the robots can do it, then they'll do it that way. But I think ultimately we are moving, obviously, towards more mechanization of low-skill labor. So it's going to be primarily a service economy in coming years. And I think we're only beginning to see the birth pangs of that that new system. And it's not going to be pretty for a lot of people. It may ultimately end up being better for the economy in the same way that it's better to have cars and all of the infrastructure that we have today than it was to be going around in horses and buggies 100 years ago. But people who were making horses and buggies going out of work, for them that was a real economic shift and transition that had to be made with a lot of pain. And it's not going to be fun for the people who are already in those types of jobs that we have now that are soon going to be replaced.
And I could also see in the future robots being taxed to help support the people they replaced.
You never know. The way things are going, if it moves, it will be taxed.
Boy, you should be in government with that kind of attitude. James, how can people subscribe to your newsletter?
People who are interested should go to theinternationalforecaster.com, and there you can find a free copy of The International Forecaster. I write the lead editorial for that twice a week. It comes out twice a week. It's about 30 to 40 pages of information about the markets, about things that are happening in the U.S. economy and worldwide. Very interesting resource. I hope people will at least check out the free complimentary copy at theinternationalforecaster.com. People who are interested in my own work, please go to CorbettReport.com, CorbettReport.com. All my work there is available for free download and viewing.
My guest has been James Corbett, publisher of The Corbett Report and reporter for The International Forecaster. Coming up next, international real estate expert Robert Campbell on This Week in Money.
This Week in Money is archived online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com.
My guest is Robert Campbell, publisher of the Campbell Real Estate Timing Letter. Welcome to the show, Robert.
Oh, fine. Thank you for inviting me to speak with you again.
What does your September newsletter tell us? What's the main headline?
The main headline, this issue is, this is no time for complacency, as if there ever is. And what the subject matter is that when I put my money at risk in the market, and I'm always doing so, I'm a real worrier. I'm always worried that the guillotine is going to come down on my neck at any time, so I'm always risk adverse, even though I'm not afraid to take risks. I'm always taking that, in my view, based on the programs I use to invest money, well-calculated risk where the odds are in my favor. Recently, that the investment strategy that I use and many of my subscribers use that I've shared with them for investing money, it's a diversified trend following program that invests in the four major asset classes: real estate investment trust, U.S. stock market, U.S. bonds, and commodities. And for the first time in 7.5 years, it put all into 100% cash. So what I'm saying is it's a fairly rare event that this occurs, and that what it's saying is that the markets right now, all the markets, investors are risk adverse. They're pulling their money out of these key market sectors and going to cash. And of course, you know, it's the people that make the trends. And that the last time this happened was in 2008. So it has me worried right now, you know, just based on what the U.S. stock market's doing, what the world markets are doing, what commodities are doing, what all the asset classes are doing. And it wouldn't surprise me one bit if we're on the approaching a, you know, hard market downturns for, you know, not only the asset classes, but also the global and U.S. economy. Nevertheless, however, I should say this. everything I'm looking at right now, because I'm primarily a trend follower with respect to U.S. real estate markets, everything is still going up. Everything is still going up. So it's no time to panic out of those markets, but I like to keep my subscribers on their toes at all times, saying that I'm not liking what I'm seeing right now, even though the trend in housing is up.
Well, we've seen in Canada, real estate prices in Vancouver and Toronto have gone up. Although in the oil patch in Alberta, prices are vulnerable, sales are down. Are you seeing the same thing in the U.S. oil patch?
Not really. I mean, where the oil production, the big oil production has come recently has been from, you know, North Dakota. And that's not one of the, there's no major city up there that I follow. However, with respect, you know, the state of Texas is, has a heavy presence in the oil market. And Dallas is one of the highest performing cities in the United States. And, even though I don't follow Houston, I know that Houston is still doing, is still hanging in there too. So it hasn't, the oil problem with oil prices hasn't impacted any U.S., housing markets, major U.S. housing markets. Yet.
Is there any truth to the myth that places like London, New York, and Vancouver, and I would include the entire U.S. West Coast on that, that those real estate markets are relatively bulletproof?
That's, nothing could be farther from the truth. Speaking of, you know, I can't speak so much about London, and of course Vancouver. I know you guys have been in a huge bull market up there for a long time. But with respect to the West Coast, which is a very predominant market, three of the California cities that I follow, San Francisco, Los Angeles, and San Diego, during the last market downturn after the real estate bubble burst, prices in California in general went down 55% for the whole state, 55% from peak values before they hit bottom. So I wouldn't classify that as bulletproof.
Right. Is there such a thing as a bulletproof real estate investment?
No, there's no such thing as any bulletproof investment, including real estate. All investments have their days in the sun and their days in the darkness.
What do you see as a major trend in real estate? I know people like physical assets when there are bad times, but is it a bad time to grab something right now?
So what type of physical asset?
Well, it just tends to be, you know, they get out of the equity market and they want something tangible. And so often people say real estate can be tangible.
Uh-huh. And that may explain why the U.S. housing markets are still trending higher. However, one of the key asset classes that I invest in is commodities. That's as tangible as any asset class. That has been in a bear market for the last year, and prices are down almost 30%. So you got to be careful when you say tangible. You got to be careful what kind of tangible, because it always reverts back to the old question: at what price? See, why commodities are going down is the so-called Chinese miracle was largely driven by borrowed money and Ponzi finance. You know, driving the price of copper and gold and all other type of commodity type of products. You know, wheat and anything else, iron ore. You know that, you know, China was going to keep growing and growing and growing forever, and of course they couldn't stockpile enough of that stuff, right? So they kept buying and buying and buying, and drove those prices to you know, super high levels. Well, guess what? Now they're finding out China isn't quite the miracle they thought it was, and those prices are crashing. So it all comes back to at what price, you know, that you're buying into a physical asset. And obviously, if commodities are going down right now and the value of cash is going up, the people that the smart money is thinking that, you know, that cash is the best investment, the safest place for your money, and the commodities are going to go lower, or else there'd be, you know, they'd be catching some bids, and they're really not. Hell, oil has been a heck of a commodity, you know, for over the course of the last 50-100 years. Look what's happening to oil. It's getting crushed.
Does it help that Iran's going to be putting millions of barrels of oil on the market as well very soon?
Well, you know, I'm strictly a technical investor. I invest by the numbers. that I'm more interested in what's happening than why it's happening. And there are so many things going on in the world right now that's just incredible to me. I mean, the fact that oil is down where it is right now, with the unrest in the Middle East being what it is, and with the, you know, a Cold War, you know, building again between Russia and the United States and maybe even China, and the fact that oil prices, you know, most of the oil, you know, most of the world's production of oil comes out of the Middle East. You know, Russia's the number one producer, but that comes out of the Middle East. Wouldn't you think that a possible disruption would be sending the price of oil, you know, higher as opposed to lower? So that doesn't make sense to me at all from a rational standpoint. But all I know is that the price of oil keeps trending down. So obviously there must be a huge supply out there that you know, many of us aren't aware of.
Well, I was told a lot of the excess oil was stored in giant tankers, and they've reached capacity. They've got to get rid of the oil somewhere because...
Yeah, I heard that too. You know, they said, oh yeah, oil's just fine, you know, and the tankers are just sitting out there, you know, full of it, waiting to deliver it after the price recovers. I think that's when oil was, you know, crude was trading at about 50 or so. Well, those tankers are going to be sitting out there a long time, probably. In fact, who was it? Even though the last source of information I trust is Goldman Sachs, and I shouldn't even be quoting them, but they think oil's going down to 20. And somebody else that I shouldn't even mention Goldman Sachs, a guy by the name of Martin Armstrong, who's been incredibly accurate over the course of the last 5 years, and I've watched him, and I'm pretty hard to impress. He thinks oil's going down to going down into the low 30s.
Right. Well, I interviewed Martin Armstrong about a week ago.
Terrific! I'm happy to hear that, because he is one of the few people that I follow on a daily basis, read his blogs, and like I say, I'm not an easy person to impress, but I'm impressed with Martin Armstrong. And as you may know, see, here's something interesting. You know, Martin Armstrong thinks October 1st of this year is based on his cycle theory, is the next global down cycle. And it's going to be a hard down cycle. So all of a sudden, I'm looking at my trend following system putting me in cash in all the major asset classes about a month before October 1st. It kind of makes me wonder that if those two events aren't connected.
Well, Martin does keep his eye on what's going on in the world. Why do you think his sources are so much more reliable than a big house like Goldman Sachs?
Well, one, he's unbiased. He's unbiased. I know that. He has no axe to grind. He really has nothing to sell. And I like that about him. And I've just studied his work and read everything he's published. You know, probably, you know, I was reading the stuff he was published while he was still incarcerated. And I thought it was real good. And I just think, I like his approach. I like, even though I've never been a cycle guy in the past, because, you know, I've been tracking markets for, my God, since I was 18 years old. So, you know, we're talking 50 years now. And I've looked at everything, and I never found anything that had to do with cycles. It was anything that I could base my, you know, decisions when to buy, when to sell. So he's kind of a big picture kind of a guy. And, you know, and then I followed him for 5 years, and I said, he's been right about gold. He got you out of gold at or near the top. He's been telling you to stay out of gold. And we're talking paper gold, of course, not physical. And he's been right about that. He's been right about the U.S. stock market. He's been right about the cycles of war, about how social unrest are going to develop and, you know, keep getting more and more intense because people are totally dissatisfied with the government. He's been right about the euro. He's been right about so many things. You know, he's not a short-term trader by any means, but I've learned to respect him. And, you know, this, you know, October 1st, 2015, I think he calls that the Big Bang. I'm not anticipating that to be a, you know, a hard date where everything's going to fall apart, you know, at 12 o'clock noon. But nevertheless, I believe him, and what I'm seeing myself with my own two eyes in the markets today, I'm saying, I think this guy's right on.
We'll have more with international real estate expert Robert Campbell coming up on This Week in Money.
Unbelievable harmonies, spectacular performance, Bird Dog and the Vintage Electric Band, the ultimate tribute to the Everly Brothers and Simon and Garfunkel in Oliver, October 2nd, in Kelowna, October 3rd. Buy online and save at OnTourTickets.com.
Welcome back to This Week in Money. I'm Jim Goddard. We're speaking to international real estate expert Robert Campbell. Getting back to real estate, are there certain markets that you would say to people, this is a good place, and other markets where you'd be pretty scared to get in?
San Francisco, the San Francisco market, it has gone up. Prices have doubled in the last 2.5 years. That has to be a bubble. It has to be a bubble. Now, I know Chinese, you know, I know Chinese money is flowing in because there's a lot of scared money, international money on the run from China, from Europe, maybe even from Japan that's flowing into the United States because they think this is the last Ponzi scheme, this is going to be the last Ponzi scheme to fail, and it's driving up prices. But anytime you see prices go up like that, you know, to that degree, you know, doubling in 2.5 years, it's a bubble. It's well over a 2-standard deviation event, and it's probably close to a 3-standard deviation event. And in any market that's ever been tracked, 3-standard deviation events, you know, occur. That's the equivalent of about the 500-year, once every 500-year flood, and they all crash. I'm not so sure that the Vancouver housing market, I know that's done exceptionally well over the course of the last 10 years, but I don't think in any 2.5-year period it went up 100%, has it?
No, it sure certainly has it, maybe 5 to 8.
Right, yeah. So we're talking about an extreme rise, and so that's a market that I would avoid. Or, I mean, these bubble markets, you know, can go on for a long time. You know, if you've got, if you're really a daredevil, you can still jump on board, you know, and try to, you know, make some money in this market. But I'll tell you, when my key indicators flash sell, and San Francisco is one of the markets, California markets I track rather closely, I would be heading for the exits. I wouldn't be, dilly-dallying or complacent and say, oh, I think we're okay, because you're probably not going to be okay.
Well, I notice they've just started a reality TV show about the San Francisco real estate market with all these real estate agents bragging about how many Lamborghinis and Ferraris they own. Maybe they won't
be
bragging
sign,
much
right?
longer. Pardon?
That has to be a sign, right?
Well, exactly.
I wasn't aware of that.
It'll be nice to have the cameras there to capture the looks on their faces when their property values start to fall.
Oh, absolutely. And it'll go into a free fall fast where there'll just be no bids. There'll be just no bids. You know, that's what happened during when the bubble collapsed in Phoenix, in Las Vegas, in Miami, and in the California markets. Of course, you know, Phoenix, Miami, and Las Vegas, they suffered worse declines. I think they went down, you know, 60 to 70%. You know, whereas California only fell a little over 50. So on a relative basis, California real estate's a better place to be during a downturn, right?
Well, in Vancouver, in the last few downturns here, all the losses were recovered within a year or two.
Right. But you guys are in recession right now. You guys are in an economic recession. You've had two quarterly prints that were negative, correct? Consecutive.
Yes.
That's a recession. How the heck can your real estate market withstand that much longer? Especially if Martin Armstrong's right and the whole world's going into recession. Betting for that to happen, for housing prices not to go down in Canada in a big way, I think you would be betting against long odds.
And of course, Toronto, they have something like 70,000 condos on the market.
Are they selling?
Well, right now maybe, but they must have a lot of empty buildings as well.
See, I mean, the housing activity, you have to be careful about what the inventory is, because even inventory is increasing in the United States in all the cities I'm following. Offsetting that, however, is existing home sales are increasing at an even faster pace. So what that means is the supply of homes per buyer out there is going down. So that you can't look at just one item in a vacuum. You have to consider the big picture here, which is, you know, not only inventory, but is demand increasing or decreasing? And here in the States, and maybe Toronto, my guess, you know, I can't comment about Toronto. I'm not even going to. But in the States, yes, inventory is increasing, but the demand for houses is increasing at an even faster pace. So that's what's putting upward pressure on prices.
A lot of people are telling me one of the reasons why they're buying homes now is they expect interest rates to go up. up, so they want to get cheap mortgages now. Is that a good idea?
Well, no. I mean, you know, of the five key indicators that I follow, one of which is interest rates, but that's the least predictive. You know, least predictive of all the five key indicators that I follow. And there can be a short-term phenomenon where all of a sudden, the trend is up and all of a sudden interest rates start ticking up a little bit. And that definitely gets some of the people off the fence and encourages them to buy. So you get some, a short-term increase in demand. But does the direction in interest rates have any, real significant long-term effects, in the range that they're in right now as far as supply and demand? Not really. Not really.
Bob, how can people subscribe to your newsletter?
They can go to my website, realestatetiming.com, and they can read some sample issues. And if they want to buy my book, Real Estate Timing, Timing the Real Estate Market, or they want to subscribe to my newsletter, they can do it right there. Real easy.
Bob, thanks a lot for chatting with us.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me. Bye.
My guest has been Robert Campbell, the editor of the Campbell Real Estate Timing Letter. That wraps up the show for this week. Thanks to our guests, Ross Clark, James Corbett, and Robert Campbell. And thank you for listening. Comments or questions for This Week in Money can be emailed to info@howstreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard. We're back next week with more This Week in Money.
This Week in Money is a production of How Street Media Incorporated.